Hi students, this is Padma Priya from Avinashalingam Deemed University. So today we are going to see about the behavior therapy. Introduction. So behavior therapy can help people learn to manage and reduce aggressive impulses and compulsive behaviors and aggressive anger outbursts. It can help them improve their current coping skills or learn new ones so that they are more equipped to handle challenging or unfamiliar situations. The techniques and strategies used in behavior therapy are also fairly straightforward and easy for most clients to understand and learn. Behavior therapies have contributed to greater understanding of the learning process and have also significantly influenced measurement strategies for identifying psychological problems such as anxiety disorders. Overall, behavior therapies are not generally used on their own in treating psychological disorders. However, the techniques used in behavior therapies are applicable to treatment in a wide variety of settings. This module discusses principles, strategies of behavior therapy, strategies of learning theory, and applications of these principles and strategies in assisting the clients to replace maladaptive behaviors with adaptive behavior. So now we can discuss the objectives. Objectives formulated are defined terms specific to behavior therapy, learn and apply principles, strategies for behavior therapy, discuss the goals of behavioral therapeutic approaches, differentiate between classical and operant conditioning and other forms of behavior modifications. So now we can see about the genesis of behavior therapy. Behavior therapy was developed first in the 1950s, initially by the applications of learning theory to the treatment of a variety of neurotic symptoms. Studies of learning in animal had indicated that behaviors could be conditioned and maintained by particular patterns of stimulus and reward. For example, in Pavlov's early experiments, dogs had been conditioned to salivate in response to a bell, which originally had been sounded at the same moment as the appearance of food. That is classical conditioning. And the B.F. Skinner showed that animals repeated behaviors which were rewarded in some way, as by the presentation of food. That is the operant conditioning. Behavior therapists regarded neurotic symptoms as learned maladaptive behaviors and drew on theories of classical and operant learning to devise strategies for modifying and eradicating these behaviors. For example, Wolf treated phobic patients by exposing them progressively to the fear situations. After inducing a state of relaxation, his rational being that their fearful response would be inhibited if the formerly feared situations were associated with the pleasurable feelings. Operant methods found applications in the modifications of undesirable behaviors and in the reversal of behavioral deficits in the institutionalized chronic schizophrenic patients and the definitions of behavior therapy. Wolf, 1973, defined behavior therapy as a conditioning therapy involving the use of experimentally established principles of learning for the purpose of changing maladaptive behaviors. The essential features of behavior therapies are: behavior treatments incorporate a number of diverse techniques but have several essential features in common. Behavioral treatments are aimed primarily at the modifications of current observable behaviors. Behavioral treatments begins with a detailed behavioral analysis in which the therapist identifies the antecedents of a symptom, that is the factors which provoke it, the problem behavior itself, the behavior manifestations of the symptom and its consequences for the patients and those around him. This analysis, the ABC of the behavioral therapy, permits the therapist to decide on the most appropriate technical intervention to apply. The treatment programs are designed cooperatively by therapist and patients in order to recognize and tackle the idiosyncrasies of each individual's symptoms. The patient is recruited actively into the treatment process by being encouraged to participate in the identification of appropriate goals for treatment. The patients monitor the frequency and severity of the target symptoms as therapy progresses, often by keeping a diary of its occurrence. The therapist measures the target behavior before, during, and after treatment in order to ensure selection of the most effective therapeutic techniques and to evaluate the progress and outcome of treatment. The patient carries out homework tasks between treatment sessions. The patient's relatives or friends are recruited as co-therapists in the treatment accompanying and encouraging the patients in the agreed homework assignments. So now we can see the therapeutic goals. Following are the list of behavior therapy in individual goals: overcoming deficits in behavioral repertoires, strengthening adaptive behaviors, weakening or eliminating maladaptive behaviors, the capacity to relax, the ability to assert oneself, effective social skills, adequacy at sexual functioning, capacity for self-control. So behavior therapy has to be subjected to the following persons. Behavioral methods are applied in the treatment of some neuroses, particularly phobic anxiety states, obsessive compulsive disorders, habit disorders including tics, smoking and the eating disorders, conduct disorders in children, the mentally handicapped and the chronic schizophrenic patients, and in some marital and family disorders. Treatments are designed to reduce symptoms and behaviors which are distressing and disruptive, or to promote desirable and adaptive behaviors. In many psychiatric disorders, symptomatic behaviors trouble both the patients and those around him. Many of these behaviors are amenable to modifications and eradications by behavioral therapy. And now we can look into the process of therapy. In behavior therapy, therapists need to conduct and formulate a behavioral assessment so that treatment goals can be selected and specified. Such as assessment entails descriptions of what the problems are, how they appear to have arisen and what maintains them. Frequently, the main goals of the treatment are target behaviors, clearly defined goals assist therapists to select appropriate interventions to attain them. In most instances, client and therapist will agree on goals and treatment interventions. Where disagreement exists, further discussion may be all that is necessary to resolve the issues. Referral to another therapist may be indicated if disagreement persists. Adequate behavioral assessments allows therapists to identify the context, antecedents, and the consequences of the responses they wish to treat. While inadequately, behavioral assessment may lead to the wrong methods being applied to the wrong problems. Behavioral assessments and monitoring takes place throughout the course of behavior and not just at the beginning. One function of such monitoring is to see whether treatment goals are being achieved. Another function is to see whether therapists or clients think it advisable to alter or revise the goals. Often behavior therapy treatment is short term. For instance, therapists might contract with a client to pursue a treatment plan for 2 or 3 months and reevaluate progress at the end of this period. Therapy lasting from 25 to 50 sessions is also fairly common. Though any contract over 100 sessions is rare, behavior therapy session is vary in length, from the traditional therapeutic hour to 30 minutes when specific interventions are in use. The various assessments are behavior observation during the role play situations and observing from real life settings. The next one is self-monitoring. Clients are asked to collect baseline data by monitoring their current behavior. Questionnaire. Therapist asks the questionnaire to complete self-report questionnaires, which includes medical information. The next we are going to see about the therapeutic interventions. Behavior therapists have a collection of interventions which they tailor to assist clients to attain their goals. The various therapeutic techniques are systematic desensitization, assertive training, modeling, token economy, aversion therapy, imagery, progressive muscle relaxations. So now we can see about the system desensitizations. This is the best known and most widely used application of Wolff's reciprocal inhibition principle for the treatment of phobic reactions. It is based on the simple principle that one cannot be both relaxed and anxious at the same time. Increasingly, more anxiety-provoking stimuli were experienced while the patient is in a deeply relaxed state. The relaxation response will be substituted for the anxiety-inducing stimuli. Therapy starts with one or few interviews and the administrations of some personality questionnaires mainly intended to discover the patient's major source of anxiety. Before desensitization process begins, the patient is first trained in relaxation and an anxiety hierarchy is created. Other techniques involve hypnosis, the imagining of very relaxed situations, and attending to breathing patterns. Although some are simply unable to master the techniques, most patients can, after training, relax their whole body in a few minutes. An example of an appropriate use of systematic desensitization is the treatment of a client who has an irrational fear of elevators. The therapy would incorporate three basic steps. The first one is muscle relaxations and relaxation therapy. The second is the construction of a hierarchy representing the anxiety producing situations the client typically faces and needs to overcome. The third one is graduated and progressive pairing through emotive imaginary of the anxiety producing situations with the relaxed state of the client. The desensitization sessions would be continued until the client could stand without debilitating anxiety, to be presented with elevator schemes, and finally could go alone to an elevator and ride it without discomfort. Successful treatment requires, of course, that patients should be free of fears in real as well as imagined situations. Scientists claimed that as many as 91% of the phobic patients treated by his techniques were cured and markedly improved. Others have made more modest claims. Some have argued that desensitization is to be truly effective, must involve concurrent and systematic exposure to real life as well as imagined threats. And now we can see about the assertive training. Teaching assertive responses is conceptualized by Wolf as another illustration of the reciprocal inhibition principle. For one cannot be assertive and timorous at the same time. Thus, practicing more assertive behavior in a situation which formerly aroused anxiety and inhibition reduces the strength of the anxiety-related responses. Treatment starts with the discussion of threatening interpersonal situations, and the patient is aided in identifying appropriate expressive responses, first in more mild, later in more intense situations. The patient is encouraged to try out new behaviors. He is asked to keep notes of the significant interplays with others, what happened, how he acted, what consequences it had, and the like. This both makes the patient more attentive to his own behavior and gives the therapist information about specific problems needing attention. In time, the patient should develop an increased sense of control and adequacy. To assist in the development of the necessary skills, considerable use of behavior rehearsal is made. Behavior rehearsal is a technique similar to psychodrama, role-playing, or social modeling. The patient has to reenact past experience and anticipated difficulties of the future, with the therapist playing a complementary role. Roles may then be reversed, with the therapist acting the patient's part and the patient now the antagonist. This procedure gives the patient the opportunity to understand and understand social interactions better, discover the skill needed, practice them in the presence of a non-threatening therapist, rehearse them in role-playing, and get feedback on their effectiveness and guidance on their use in real life. And now we can see about the modeling technique. Modeling, particularly for children, an important part of learning is based on watching and imitating others. Bandura developed a form of behavior modification based on social modeling. In earlier work, he had found that a child observing an adult acting aggressive is more likely to be aggressive himself than a child not exposed to such a model. As a therapeutic measure, Bandura points to the three ways in which modeling can influence behavior. So it can serve as a basis for learning new skills and behavior. Example, the apprentice watching the master learns in this fashion. So too, withdrawn children shown a film of children interacting harmoniously subsequently showed more mature social behaviors. It can serve to eliminate fears and inhibitions. Example, observing another child playing happily with a dog can reduce the subject's fears of animal. And finally, it can facilitate pre-existing behavior patterns. Example, seeing others remove their hats as they enter building encourages us to do the same. In clinical practice, modeling has been found useful for the reduction of unrealistic fears, that is, in treating phobias. The efficacy of such an approach was demonstrated by Bandura, Blanchard, and Ritard in the treatment of snake phobias. Live modeling with participation, symbolic modeling in which subjects watched a film rather than live model interplay with a snake, systematic desensitization in the manner of Wolf involving imagined contact with snakes coupled with deep relaxation, no treatment. While all three treatment groups showed marked reduction of fear compared to the three untreated group who did not change, the method of live participant modeling was clearly superior to the others. If you can see about the token economy, one of the more recent and promising applications of the operand conditioning approach is the token economy used to modify the behavior of the institutionalized psychotic patients. As in other Skinnerian methods, emphasis is on the therapist control of the environmental reinforcement contingencies to the patient's behavior toward the end of reducing the probability of disturbed behaviors and increasing the frequency of desired ones. There are three issues to consider in developing a contingent reinforcement program in a token economy study. The staff of the institution should designate the patient's behavior felt to be desirable and hence to be reinforced. Second, a medium of exchange is established, a token that stands for something else. These are often poker chips, small cards, imitation coins, or even trading stamps, and hence to be reinforced. The backup reinforcers themselves are decided. These are the special privileges and pleasure for which the token can be traded and might include weekend passes, movie shows, TV time, special foods, or a private room. Each of these is given as price so that more tokens were required for the more desirable and fewer for the less wanted items. Similarly, wages are set so that more reinforcement is given for greater accomplishments. When the patient acts in a desired way, he receives the proper number of tokens, which he can save or spend as he wishes on a greater or lesser reward. The purpose of using token rather than primary reinforcers is that they bridge the delay between the occurrence of the desired behavior and ultimately reinforcement. Thus, as the patient makes his bed wet, sweeps the floor, take on a job, responsibility, he immediately receives the requested tokens. Aversion therapy. So, aversion therapy is a controversial technique that is infrequently used by counselors and is not recommended for most school situations with children. It is sometimes used in clinics by highly skilled therapists to help clients who want to be helped and whose maladaptive behavior are not amenable to intervention through other strategies. Aversion therapy employs procedures such as electric shock, emetics, stimulus satiations, unpleasant mental or visual imagery, or unpleasant sounds or verbal descriptions to inhibit unwanted behaviors. Competent behavior therapists have treated difficult problems such as drug and alcohol addictions, sexual deviations, smoking by combining aversive techniques with other behavioral procedures. The goal of this therapy is to get the client to associate an undesirable behavior pattern with unpleasant stimulations, or to make the unpleasant stimulations a consequence of the undesirable behavior. In clinical practice, aversion techniques have been applied mainly in the effort to eliminate addictions, destructions, or deviant behaviors. A best-known example is the management of chronic alcoholism. A emetic is mixed with alcoholic drink so that the drinking lead to sickness and vomiting. After a number of such occasions, the sight of the drink alone may lead to nausea. Similar procedures have been used to better advantage with more motivate the patients suffering from heavy smoking, obesity, and sexual problems. The next technique is imagery. Imagery is an adaptable therapeutic approach used to facilitate positive self-talk. Mental pictures under the control of and initiated by the client make correct faulty cognitions. The client pictures past significant memories and present events that combines with relaxation therapy and role-playing, increases awareness of situational events and other variables resulting in maladaptive behaviors. Imagery techniques have been used with a couple with severe marital problems. The marital partners complained of being depressed, anxious, unable to sleep, and sexually dysfunctional. Both were unable to express anger. The partners are asked to picture the parent of the opposite sex, imagine their spouse standing next to the parent, and note characteristic similarities. They therefore identified characteristics in each other they remembered in their parents with whom they had poor interpersonal relationships. When their perception of each other was changed, their relationship improved. Imagery is also an important aspect of systematic desensitizations and has been successfully used with clients experiencing phobias. Progressive muscle relaxations. The muscle relaxation is a potent treatment strategy for dealing with a variety of client problems such as psychological distress, chronic sleeplessness, and so forth. Anxiety lessens when muscle relax. More than 40 years ago, Edmund Jacobson recognized that muscle relaxation was a therapeutic tool for stress-related problems. After studying the physiological and psychological effects of muscle relaxation, he comfortably positioned clients and taught them to tense and relax the main muscle groups of their bodies. He then shared the monitoring information with the clients who were eventually able to use only passive activity to relax. Wolf, 1973, demonstrated that progressive muscle relaxations combined with the mental pictures of fear situations or increased association with the feared object in graduated increments could desensitize phobic clients. Muscle relaxation is physiologically incompatible with the anxiety-evoking response. So now we can see the conclusions. Hope this module gave an insight into the principles of behavior therapy, strategies of learning theory, and the applications of these principles and strategies in assisting clients to replace maladaptive behaviors with adaptive behaviors. Learning refers to the process that brings about a change in behavior. Behavior therapy has proven to be a practical, efficient, parsimonious way of assisting clients and families to change their behaviors by the applications of learning theories. Behavior therapy is the essence of behaviorism. Behaviorism is a philosophical approach to life as well as a psychological discipline built on a precise scientific orient to the problem of man and to her living organisms. Behaviorism represents reality and therefore views behavior that is outside of the expected social norms as maladaptive, not as the symptoms of disease, a form of deviance or deficit.